Alrighty, hello again, everyone, and welcome to it, the Daily Caller Podcast, the Friday video edition. As we do always, we thank you for listening. Thanks for watching. However this is getting into your head, we appreciate the hell out of it. And as we do every Friday, we bring in real people from their lives who've done things that are much better than we could ever aspire to, and ask them, pick their brains, find their knowledge. And we have two today, so we've got double the pleasure. We're joined by Molly Hemingway and Carrie Serovino. And I pronounced
Severino.
That? Severino. I have dyslexia, so I can claim that as an excuse. The new book, I'm just going to go and declare it a bestseller. Justice on Trial, The Kavanaugh Confirmation and the Future of the Supreme Court. Congratulations on the book, first of all. I have to know, before we get into the substance of the book and the drama that was the confirmation, how'd the book idea come about? Which one of you came up with it?
Well, so we knew this was one of the most important things that happened to the country last year, and we both knew that there were real stories there that hadn't been told. So Molly was covering it as a journalist. I was working on it more from the inside from a group that was trying to advance the nomination. And we knew there were important stories out there to be told, and finally decided to team up because it really, I think, maximized both of our strengths knowing it. We had a lot of access to some of the key players as a result of what we had the work we had done before, and that meant we could talk to people like the president and the vice president, people in the White House counsel's office, many members of the Supreme Court. We had dozens of senators and their staff, and then people that knew the Kavanaughs or people that knew Christine Blasey.
You did more than 100 interviews for this.
Oh, yes, hundreds of hours.
We interviewed more than 100 people. Many of the people that we interviewed, we did many interviews with each of them.
And multiple hours of interviews. Yeah. Really.
So how do you sit down and, like, it was a huge drama. How do you decide? How do you whittle the list of people? And who surprised you the most that they said, yes, I'll sit down with you. You talk to Supreme Court. You talk to the President of the United States. I mean, when you send that request out, you think, oh, you got to do it. You got to check that box, blah, blah, blah. And you get the call back. The President is willing to sit down with you.
So it was such an interesting work of reporting, and I am the reporter. Carrie doesn't even have that background, but she turned out to be
the Judicial Crisis
Network. I just had a very intensive apprenticeship in reporting over the last.
She did an amazing.
Get away as quickly as you can.
I'm normally on the other side of the microphone, so it was a neat.
But no, she did an absolutely amazing job, and part of it was just about, we did know because we had been involved in it. We already knew who some of the key figures were, and we did talk to some of them first to kind of lay out a general overview of what happened and what we're going to want to get into. But every single interview that we did, you would get these little breadcrumbs about who else you might want to talk to or who else might have a good story. And so it was just about taking our core team and then people that we wanted to interview and then building out from each of them. And the thing I really liked about it is people will tell you their perspective on a particular thing that happened. And as enough people tell you their perspective, you start to get a really, you know, it's like that tale of the elephant being described from different angles. You start to get an idea of what's happening in a way that people don't even intend to tell you the details.
The Jeff Flake compromise.
So, right, that's where, and it happens in this anteroom outside of the Senate Judiciary Committee hearing room. And you have all these senators that are packed into this tiny space. Some of them are secreted away in the tiny bathroom. You've got Jeff Flake and Senator Coons wrapped up in this tiny phone booth, trying to negotiate everything. And then outside of those, in the hallway, but still in the room, it has a hallway and a little thing.
Oh, you've got people in the Senate. It's a mess.
You have people actually nearly coming to blows in anger over some of the shenanigans that they've
staffers
been deployed.
Staffers or Senate?
Senators.
Senators.
So there are staffers that are in there. The senators are constantly trying to get the staffers out, but there's no room for them to go. And outside of the room, people are trying to get in. So it's just, it gets up to be like 100 degrees. And when we first heard people talk about it, we thought, this sounds absurd. And by the 20th person that we talked to who was there was like, this just sounds like the craziest thing that's ever happened.
And when you've got dozens of people there, there's a lot of
different
right,
yes.
of that story.
And so what was the most surprising? What did you learn while doing this?
It's hard to even, you know, there's so many really fascinating moments. I would come home at the end of the day and be like, I can't believe we learned this.
Yes.
I think one of the things I really enjoyed was getting to see the human side of the Kavanaugh family. It was really even starting from the beginning when they're being chased by the press. And remember how everyone was camping out in front of Amy Coney Barrett's house, and they're camping out in front of the Kavanaugh's house too. And they decided, they didn't even know if he was going to get the nomination yet, but they said, we just have to leave the house. So they actually had to sneak out through this backyard path. They hid their clothes in the neighbor's treehouse, so no one would see them leaving with suitcases or something. And then just camped out in a friend's house for the duration, not knowing yet even. They packed what, you know, what they would need if they had to go to the White House for an announcement, but didn't even know yet. And then, of course, following it through, just the trauma of having of learning about the allegations, how you carry on your life. I mean, you've got these two girls in school, bringing them to school, trying to make sure that there aren't any outbursts there. And the surrounding community was incredibly supportive, actually. Obviously, not all on the same political side. Right. I think it was a wide variety.
I used to live in his neighborhood when this all happened. I was like, he must live down there because it's just a mess.
Well, and really that whole, I mean, it's amazing how consistent the community has been over the years, because there's people who live there who they all went to high school with, you know, and that it's still very much a local story because everyone is there who knew them both growing up.
There, Mrs. Kavanaugh, did they want this? Did he want this? Did Mrs. Kavanaugh want this? It had to know that this, especially now, especially under President Trump and the way that the left has been acting since Election Day or even before, that anybody he picks is going to get a hellstorm. The nomination of Brett Kavanaugh, the other justice whose name eludes me.
Merrick Garland?
No, not Merrick Garland.
Neil Gorsuch.
Yes.
Was relatively calm, although the Democrats made the nuclear option necessary, but otherwise it wasn't a circus. But you had to know that this one was going to be different. It was replacing the swing vote on the Supreme Court. How much did Kavanaugh want this? How much did Mrs. Kavanaugh want this?
We get into that in the book,
Injustice on Trial.
And it is one of the things we did learn was that Ashley Kavanaugh actually prays that Brett Kavanaugh will not get the nomination. She knows he's the most qualified. She supports him on that grounds. But it wasn't even about it being a Trump nominee. It was just that they had gone through this process twice before, and it had been absolutely brutal. During the George Bush administration, he was nominated for the court that he served on for 12 years, the D.C. Circuit Court, and he had to go through that confirmation battle twice because he didn't make it through the first time, and he had to be renominated. And he had a lot of Democratic senators who were frustrated because he had served on the Whitewater Council, and they were still angry and sore about that. And so they had found that process to be particularly difficult. Brett Kavanaugh kind of took it as he didn't expect it, that he would be the nominee. He knew that he was so close to the Bush administration that that might be a problem for President Trump. So he just had the attitude, I will put my best foot forward. I will answer every question. I will do the best work I can. If I'm not chosen, I'm not chosen, but I'm going to put all the effort into it.
Why was he chosen over the others? There were other people who were thought, Amy Coney Barrett, that's clearly the one. Mm-hmm. Why was Brett Kavanaugh the ultimate choice?
Well, one of the interesting things we learned in doing all the research for Justice on Trial was that actually his name is mentioned well before this nomination. In fact, before Trump was even elected, he was one of, if you recall, the day that Justice Scalia died, there was a Republican debate, and Trump really shocked the nation by standing up there and not just saying, I want to, with whatever Republican presidential would-be nominee has said, well, I will appoint people in the mold of Justice Scalia or in the mold of Justice Thomas or who love the Constitution. He actually got up there and gave names, and he said, I'd appoint someone like Bill Pryor or like Dianne Sykes. And people said, did he just name check a couple of people? And actually, Kavanaugh's name had been mentioned in this discussion he had with his White House counsel, Don McGahn, over who would you name. So that was really interesting. They didn't choose to mention him at the time, partly because he was in D.C. They were trying to focus their campaign on people who were not, not in on the coasts and kind of real America, and that was where Pryor and Sykes fit that mold perfectly, and partly because also the connections with the Bush White House. But it was someone that was always in the back of their minds as, this guy is a real stellar person, and someone that came up a lot because he wasn't on the first list or its expansion, that people would say, now, wait a minute, here's someone who really ought to be on this list. And he did ultimately add him to the list in November 2017. He was someone who had not just a long record in the D.C. Circuit, and that's something that any Republican president nominating someone now wants to see. They've kind of learned from David Souter, who famously came on as a total blank slate and then turned out to be one of the most liberal justices on the court. So we want someone with a record. We want someone who can articulate originalism. But one of the real distinguishing factors of the Trump list and those kind of nominees is it's someone who also has had opportunities to stand up in difficult cases and to make their mark. This isn't someone who's going to just keep their powder dry or try to keep their beliefs secret. And Kavanaugh really had that. He had some very impressive decisions on his D.C. circuit. So in one of the strongest Second Amendment cases that there had been, which is actually in a follow-on to the famous Heller case that the Supreme Court decided, he has some really strong cases about the overgrowth of the administrative state, which is a big focus of the Trump administration, where you've got these administrative agencies with no supervision, out of control, out of the constitutional system. And he had written some cases that in the D.C. circuit meant being in dissent. But his theories and his concerns about the separation of powers actually were ultimately adopted by the Supreme Court. That was something that was really impressive, that he stood up for those principles and then also was able to articulate in a way that they were ultimately vindicated by the Supreme Court.
Molly, you look like you wanted to
I was going to add some of that, but you got it
I
in
got
there.
It
so.
Well, let me ask you this about the President of the United States. I assume he didn't have any relationship prior, probably never met Brett Kavanaugh before the nomination. During this process, what did the President think of Brett Kavanaugh?
Well, as we're interviewing people, we learn more about who stayed strong throughout the nomination process and who did not. And one of the things that is intriguing, given recent Republican White House handlings of these things, is the one area that the Kavanaugh team never felt they had to worry about was the White House. Partly that was about Donald Trump. Partly that was about Don McGahn, the White House counsel. They were just steadfast. They understood that there would be bumps along the road, that there would be problems, that there might be, you know, a last-minute smear campaign of some kind. But they were steadfast. That was not the case necessarily with senators. Some of the senators were quite helpful in advancing the nomination. Others were not. But as far as President Trump, he made his decision, and he did not agonize over the decision, but he definitely thought deeply about the decision. He had a bunch of really good finalist candidates. So in a way, he could have picked any of them, and mm-hmm. they would have been fine. But he goes with his sense that it needs to be Kavanaugh. And once he makes his determination, he is steadfast with it.
Take us into the thinking of that second hearing. We'll get to Blasey Ford in a second. But the hearing was a media circus. It was a disaster. The Republicans had the prosecutor asking the questions to begin with. Then there's that moment that every conservative remembers where Lindsey Graham suddenly says, enough of this. I'm reclaiming my time. And he just rips. I've never seen that passion from Lindsey Graham before. That seemed to change the tone, not only of Lindsey Graham forever since, but of every Republican who came after him who did the same sort of thing to a much less degree. Mm-hmm. What was that moment like for the people that were participating in it that you spoke to and the people around that circle? Was that the moment that it clicked or what?
Well, one of the really fascinating things is that we learned is how the transfer of questioning happened with Rachel Mitchell to the senators. Because at the time, it wasn't really clear that is she going to ask all the questions of Kavanaugh, too? How is that going to happen? And so I don't think people knew if it was just that Lindsey Graham was fed up and just said, darn it, get that woman out of here, we're doing mm-hmm. this. Or it turns out Mitchell, so she was a really amazing person to learn more about. But she went into this whole thing thinking, I am not here to just convict someone. I want to actually learn the facts here. That's what she does is her job. She is known for doing forensic investigations and understanding what the facts are to determine whether you can bring a case in court or not. So she wanted to be very careful about this. So she disappointed some people in not being as gung-ho as they were hoping, but ultimately brought out a lot of inconsistencies in the facts that turned out to be crucial to some of those undecided votes who really were all important. But she didn't have a lot that she could do in terms of questioning Kavanaugh, because if he says he wasn't there, and there's not a specific, you know, there's not that much of a specific date, so you can only go so much into, right. Well, where were you during the entire summer of 82? And my gosh, of all people in the nation who actually know where they were during the summer of 1982, Brett Kavanaugh has a pretty, it was amazing. I'm sure people are going, really, I can't believe we picked the one guy to pull this on that has calendars in detail. But, you know, so she knew you can't fill up a half an hour with just that. So she really only had a few questions for him and then was getting ready to hand it over and they didn't even go through, like, who do I look at? So she kind of, right before it was Graham's turn, happened to be looking over, and I can't remember if she connected eyes with Grassley or with Graham and just kind of indicated, I'm done. And then, boy, he I think, after watching this and after being someone where his policy and was really one of the few left among the Republican senators who said, I'm just going to kind of vote for everyone as long as they're marginally qualified, you know, I mean, I'm sure he would say more qualified. As long as they're qualified, I'll vote for them, right? And he said that in his thing. He's like, look, I have been reaching out to you guys for decades. He voted for Kagan. He voted for Sotomayor. He voted for all of them, and there's no reciprocity. In fact, the Democrats were incredibly poorly behaved in this whole process, from hiding the allegations, from the way they were playing politics behind the scenes that we also, you know, go into a little bit. So that was something that I think he just was feeling for so long watching it, that exploded there. And I think it tapped into things that a lot of other Americans were also feeling and kind of made them have permission to express that frustration as well.
Yes, but it wasn't just that he'd been slimed that day. He'd been slimed for weeks leading up to it, and there had been no defense of it. You know, nobody had defended Brett Kavanaugh except for the guy who runs the committee, Charles Grassley, at the beginning, and when the testimony opened. And nobody had been defending him for weeks as his name was being dragged through the mud through all these media stories that were lacking substance, were lacking evidence, and yet the media narrative was just running wild. So when he comes out, well, first when Kavanaugh delivers his testimony, but then when Graham does this thing, cathartic is exactly how I would describe it too.
How it was unprecedented for a Supreme Court nominee to give a media interview. But he sat down with Martha McCallum. What was the thinking behind that? Where did that originate from? Was the White House briefed ahead of time? Tell us the story behind that.
Right.
That was pivotal.
Yes, it is. I'm glad that you know that this has never been done before. There were so many things that happened in this confirmation battle that had never been done before. A Supreme Court nominee being on TV to give an interview, I mean, it's just something that
it's
decades
hard
enough
to ago. To get a Supreme Court justice for an interview, let
well,
alone
that would,
a
yeah.
nominee.
Decades ago, Supreme Court nominees wouldn't even address anything. It was really a testament to how bad the situation was that the team felt that an interview was necessary. They realized pretty early on, you've got, yes, he did his hearings a few weeks, or, you know, by that point, a few weeks prior. Not that many people were paying attention. Most of the narrative was about the chaos of those hearings. Then you've got weeks of unending smears again. So they knew they needed to get him out in front of the American people just so people could remember who he was and see him on his own terms and not as the media were describing him. But we do get into it in Justice on Trial about who the different people were who were trying to get that nominee, why they ended up going with Martha McCallum, how people predicted that interview would go and how it was at odds with how she actually did do a pretty tough interview, and then also what they learned from it. At that time, Judge Kavanaugh was getting different conflicting advice from different people that were in his friend set or group of advisors. And we kept hearing people say that there was this Bushy approach and there was a Trump approach. The Bushy approach, by the way, the people who were saying these things were sometimes, they would speak against the Bush approach, but they themselves had worked in the Bush administration. So it took us a while to figure out that what they were really talking about was an attitudinal approach. So the Bushy approach would have been to just constantly talk about how much you love women and how helpful you've been to women and talk about Christine Blasey Ford's bravery and coming out and telling her story. And the Trump approach was you fight back to defend your honor. And so he's dealing and wrestling with these different pieces of advice. When he sees how the Martha McCallum interview goes and when everyone sees how that goes, they understand that that approach is not going to cut it. So it ends up being a very pivotal moment, not just to get out some new important information, such as why he knew he had not sexually assaulted someone in high school, because he was not sexually active in high school. That was actually very important information that undercut the claims that were being made, but also so he could see how different styles play on TV.
Well, his opening statement was allegedly rewritten by him the night before the retrial, not the retrial, but the Blasey Ford hearing. And it was very passionate and angry, and he teared up. And I think that was a pivotal moment. It was much better, much different, as you said, from the Martha McCallum interview. Let's talk about Dr. Blasey Ford. I call her Blasey Ford. It's just kind of snarky. But she allegedly didn't want to be known. She wanted to remain in the background. Yet before she reached out, she disappeared herself from the internet. Why? How? Everybody is online somewhere. When she came out, she was impossible to find. Talk a little bit about the build-up to her and that leaked letter to Dianne Feinstein.
Yeah, that was interesting to see how that went down because, you know, if you or I just decides to go off of Facebook, go off of Twitter,
it's 30 days or
something
like that.
You can cancel your account, but there are still remnants floating around there on the internet probably forever. This was a very thorough, very professional job of evaporating from the internet. And it was interesting to talk to people who had known her, who had been familiar with her Facebook feed, for example, and said, this isn't the person who is just, oh, maybe marginally a little left of center and just not really politically active. She actually had a very, you know, anti-Trump, very liberal take on things in that Twitter or in her Facebook feed in particular. So that's something that kind of was at odds with the portrayal in the kind of public relations side of this. The other thing that we point out, I mean, no one can tell her what is in her heart in terms of what her real goals here were, because she did say she didn't want to go on publicly with this. But it is interesting that, you know, you have this clear public relations approach to the beginning. And then you also, the first people she reached out to, according to her account, is the Washington Post tip line. And she has some texts back and forth with them. And then when they don't seem to be taking action on it, she actually says, well, I can always go to the New York Times with this. And that of course, lights a little fire under them. But that's not a typical type of behavior for someone who doesn't actually want to go public. And then, of course, the letter to Dianne Feinstein, which, again, Feinstein says she's trying to protect her confidentiality while not mentioning that there are confidential procedures for doing this. There was a whole FBI process that was literally invented for this type of situation. It was created after the Anita Hill hearings with Justice Thomas. So you could investigate claims like this and not just ignore them, but you don't have to create a media circus. You don't have to expose both accuser and the nominee to this kind of public scrutiny. And then the senators can decide whether it's something that actually has substantiation should be followed up on. That is something that she ignored. And, of course, then eventually it got leaked, whether from her office or other Democratic senators, whether from Blasey Ford's own team. We don't know. But it was a very small universe of people who had that letter.
Looking back on it, just your opinions, the circus that followed with Michael Avenatti coming out and everybody and their brother saying, oh, I remember this, and the idea of the gang rape parties that Kavanaugh was running when he was 15 years old, that hurt, I think, the cause. Would Kavanaugh have made it if it had just been Blasey Ford and not the rest of the caboose on the clown car?
I suppose it's impossible to know for sure, but I certainly think that Michael Avenatti was a key figure in advancing Brett Kavanaugh's confirmation, and we spoke with people who were highly involved in the process who absolutely give him credit for helping Brett Kavanaugh get through. When the first allegation came out, there was no evidence in support of it, but it was at least within the realm of possible things that could have taken place on planet Earth. As the subsequent allegations come out, they get increasingly more ludicrous. And so it is worth remembering Michael Avenatti's claim, which he boasted about on Twitter, was that he had a client who had been to a series of gang rape parties where she was an adult, but that Brett Kavanaugh was underage and the victims were underage, that as an adult she didn't report these crimes against children.
And
she went back.
Yeah, there's a lot of gang rape, but the music's really good and there's
right.
free beer.
Excellent.
Like, what? That doesn't make any sense.
Right, and so seeing that allegation and the absurdity of it, although it is worth noting that that was the only allegation that actually had a sworn affidavit with it. So the media like to say, oh, yeah, that one was bad, but these others were good. Actually, none of the allegations were particularly well-sourced, and I think journalists who have integrity should have been a sketch more critical of what they were hearing.
You're looking for a unicorn if you're looking for a journalist with integrity. As a journalist, and as somebody who's worked with a journalist, what would you say was the most egregious fit of journalism that you saw watching this thing unfold and looking back on it?
For me, one of the worst things that I think we saw was related to Michael Avenatti. There are really so many, and this is just one that kind of stands out right now, but NBC News actually had information so Michael Avenatti brought forth this claim, and he said he had a second witness who would support the claims. NBC News knew that second witness did not support the claims, and they sat on that information. They knew it before his confirmation vote. They sat on it for weeks, only revealing it quietly weeks later.
Did they ever explain why? I haven't seen an explanation.
No, and they don't need to, because our journalists are currently in the business of giving each other awards for their bad coverage rather than firing people or holding people accountable or making sure that they, you know, promote people who are not going to follow into mob hysteria.
Carrie, you've said in interviews that the reason you wrote this is for posterity, the rewriting, the revision of history that is to come. And you've referenced the Clarence Thomas, Anita Hill situation. Explain that.
Yeah, so I clerked for Justice Thomas. So obviously this is a story that I'm familiar with, that most Americans who lived through that saw how those hearings played out. And it was really chilling, actually, to see the same pattern be followed again, where there's first they try to defeat him by misconstruing his record, then we have this leaked allegation, then we have a circus of a second hearing. And unfortunately, it doesn't end with, and then he got confirmed and they all lived happily ever after. At the time he was confirmed, 2-1 Americans, male, female, black, and white, believed Thomas Overhill. And ever since he was confirmed, the left didn't just go home. They continued their campaign. They tried to revise history. They tried to, continue to change and shape that narrative. So if you took those polls today, you would not see those same numbers again. The people who knew it and saw it in the time saw what was really happening, but that's not what history remembered, unfortunately. We wanted to make sure that didn't happen again because we know they're not going home. At this point, there's going to be a campaign to make this into, again, the cause celebre of another generation. So getting the facts out there and making sure that we were well-sourced and well-researched in all of them was really important, because if Americans forget what happened here, that's the best way to encourage it to happen again. We know there's going to be more confirmations coming, and if this was what it looked like when you were replacing a swing vote on the court, imagine what it would look like if Trump was replacing, say, Justice Ginsburg or another member of the liberal bloc on the court. It would be out of control, and we need to be prepared and understand what happened so we don't allow it to happen again.
Do you think there are people on that Trump list who look at what happened to Kavanaugh and say, maybe through back channels, I appreciate it. I just don't. There's no way I can go through that.
I have to imagine that there are. It would be weird if people didn't think that after seeing what this family went through. And seeing that it happened with someone like Brett Kavanaugh, who really did have this reputation that was well established over decades, you would have to imagine that it would be difficult for people. We did speak with a Supreme Court justice who pointed out that there are people who, lose limbs in service of their country all the time. And if you're not willing to stand up to a tough confirmation battle, that maybe the court isn't for you. In a way, it is the ultimate test for that courage issue that you brought up that President Trump was looking for. Not just having the right judicial philosophy, not just having the record, but do you have the courage of your convictions to stand through? That's becoming one of the most important issues of our age, and unfortunately, a confirmation process that should have some level of decorum might be the ultimate test of that.
Lastly, for both of you, about Justice on Trial, just tell me what you want people to know from this book. It's a substantial book. Most books are about 100 pages less than, having written one, it's about 100 pages less than this. There's a lot of footnotes, a lot of research. But you have an idea when you hand this to somebody or somebody buys it, you hope that when they turn that last page, they go, this is what I want to stick with them. What do you want to stick with them?
Well, one of the things that I was impressed to learn was the level of coordination that was happening on the left. Again, you think this is this is not just a spontaneous movement that came up. There were groups on the left who shockingly were admitting out loud to having flown people in, to giving them the messaging points so that they were all on the same message.
It wasn't organic.
One of them even said, look, this isn't chaos. This is scripted. And so, but a lot of people, I think, assumed it was a lot more organic than it was. And then you had even senators who admitted, were saying things that clearly showed them cooperating with that, saying, oh, wasn't it great that we had Blasey Ford wearing a blue dress to invoke Anita Hill's own teal dress. So I think it's just they let the mask slip. I think we just need to go in with eyes wide open and not be willing to be fooled by another, public relations campaign if this kind of thing happens again.
As this book has been out, we've been hearing from people who've read it and read it quickly, which is really amazing. And I love hearing what they take out of reading this, and they each take different things. If it's remembering about media malpractice, if it's remembering about some of the dirty tricks engaged in by politicians. This is a very personal thing, but my sister was telling me as she was reading it that she was thinking about just how everything you do matters, and how just normal citizens, how their votes matter, and how we hold people accountable matters. And I think that's a really important thing. You touched on this earlier. If people forget this history, it allows it to continue and to be on guard against it in the future. People who went through the Thomas hearings were on guard for this. People who went through these hearings need to be on guard for what's about to come, and being informed is the first step of a long list of things that we need to do.
Molly Hemingway, Carrie Severino. Said it right.
Yep. Yes.
Justice on Trial, the book is out now. They're going to sign these books for you, one for me, two for you. You just have to email Derek@dailycaller.com, put in the message in the subject line that you want to be entered to win it. And if you've bought a copy, send me a screen capture of your receipt and you'll be entered twice. Thank you both for coming in. Congratulations with the book.
Thank you.
I'll ask you what everybody asked me when my book first came out. When's the next one? Not in a hurry.
We did so much in such a little period of time. Yeah, we've been getting that already. It's like, well, let's let this one set where it
was. Let it sink in.
Let it digest. Live a little. Congratulations on the book.
Thank you.
We'll see you guys on Monday. Have a great weekend.